Hey everybody, and welcome to Number Theory Lecture Number 2. Today we're going to start talking about propositions on the set of natural numbers. And we have to do that if we're going to study induction, weak induction and strong induction. And the reason is that every proof involving induction involves a proposition on the set of natural numbers. So let's just once and for all nail down this concept, and then we'll move on to induction. A proposition on the set of natural numbers, denoted P, evaluated at N, is a function whose domain is the set of natural numbers, and whose range is the set of logical values T and F. T represents the logical value true. F represents the logical value F. Now let's look at an example or two of propositions on the natural numbers. Okay. Let's consider an example of a proposition on the natural numbers. For all natural numbers, little n, we define P evaluated at n, the proposition P evaluated at n, to be the proposition n squared minus 5 is greater than 0. And for any natural number n, this is going to be either true or false, but not both. For example, if we take 1 and plug it in for n, we have 1 squared minus 5, which is negative 4, is greater than 0. This is false. Thus, the proposition P evaluated at 1 is false. Okay. The statement 2 squared minus 5 greater than 0. 2 squared is 4, minus 5 is negative 1. Negative 1 is not greater than 0. So this is false also. The proposition evaluated at 2 is false. About one more. The statement 3 squared minus 5 greater than 0. 9 minus 5 is 4. That is greater than 0. That's true. Thus, our proposition P, evaluated at 3, equals T, true. Ta-da! The principle of weak induction, the first principle of mathematical induction. Now, typically, in a textbook, they'll just say that this is the principle of mathematical induction. But there are actually two principles, and sometimes we do what is called weak induction. Sometimes we do a proof by what we call strong induction. And there's a slight difference in how we proceed. The principle of weak induction. Let P of n be a proposition on the natural numbers, and suppose that the proposition is true for n equal 1, and that whenever the proposition is true for n equal k, then the proposition is also true for n equal k plus 1. So if our proposition evaluated at k is true, then the proposition evaluated at k plus 1 is true also. And I'm not saying this always happens. I'm saying if this happens. So suppose that the proposition evaluated at 1 is true. And suppose that whenever the proposition evaluated at k is true, the proposition evaluated at k plus 1 is also true. Then it turns out that the proposition is true for all natural numbers n. So if we want to show that a proposition is true for all natural numbers n, using weak induction, there are two steps. First, show that the proposition is true for n equal 1. And this, step 1, establishing that the claim is true for n equal 1, is called the basis step. You know what? I have step 1 here, and I have A and B up here. What the heck? Just for the sake of consistency, let me do that. So step 1, establishing the claim that the proposition is true for n equal 1, is called the basis step. So we establish that this is true. That's the basis step. The assumption that if the proposition is true for n equal k, for some natural number k, I'm sorry, I'm saying this very badly. Let me give it one more try. A third try ought to work. The assumption that the proposition is true for some natural number k is called the induction hypothesis. So step 2, we suppose that the proposition is true for some natural number k. And whenever we do a proof by mathematical induction, we have the right to assume that the induction hypothesis is true. So whenever we do a proof by mathematical induction, we have the right to assume that our proposition is true for some natural number k. And why not? In step one, we already showed that the proposition is true for n equal 1. So this is in fact true. Whenever we do a proof by induction, we have to assume that for some natural number k, the proposition is true. And you'll see that I didn't finish what I was writing down here. Ran out of space. So let me just finish it up here. Specifically, we must use this assumption whenever we do a proof by mathematical induction. If we do a proof by mathematical induction, and in our proof we haven't used the assumption that P is true for some natural number k, then that's not a proof by mathematical induction. Our proof is not correct. So let's review the steps again. To prove something by mathematical induction, we show that the proposition is true for n equal 1. And then we assume that the proposition is true for some natural number k, and show that that means it has to be true for the natural number k plus 1 also. Showing that the proposition is true for n equal 1 is called the basis step. And the assumption that the proposition is true for some natural number k is called the induction hypothesis. And we have the right to assume that the induction hypothesis is true whenever we do a proof by mathematical induction. As a matter of fact, we have to make use of this assumption. We must use the assumption that P of K is true for some natural number K whenever we do a proof by mathematical induction. Okay, let me get down off my soapbox and we'll do an example or two of mathematical induction. Oh, before we do our example, there's one piece of terminology that I didn't let out of the bag. Step two, when we assume our induction hypothesis, when we assume that P of K is true, and we show that this implies that P evaluated at K plus 1 is true, this is called the induction step. Assuming that P of K is true implies that P of K plus 1 is true is called the induction step. Step 1, assume that P of 1 equals true. Step 2, assume that P of K is true and show that this means that P of K plus 1 is true. That's the induction step. Here's a nice little example. Not too complicated, but probably not one that we're going to find on the internet, unless you look on one of my other web pages. 3 + 7 + 11... this is, I guess, what we'd call an arithmetic sequence. Each term after the first is 4 greater than its predecessor. So this is 4 greater than 3, this is 4 greater than 7, so forth and so on. And it also has the property that for n, the nth term is equal to 4n minus 1. If n is 1, 4 times 1 minus 1 is 3. If n is 2, 4 times 2 minus 1 is 7. If n is 3, 4 times 3 minus 1 is 11, and so forth. So this is the term for n equal 1. This is the term for n equal 2. This is the term for n equal 3. This is the nth term in general. And we want to show that for this final value of n, the sum is equal to 2n squared plus n. And this is our proposition on n. Now, typically, if we have a proposition that involves a sum, we like to rewrite it using summation notation. And the nth term, we're just going to take this thing and write it in terms of I. When I is 1, this is 4 times 1 minus 1, which is 3. When I is 2, this is 4 times 2 minus 1, which is 7. When I is 3, this is 4 times 3 minus 1, which is 11, and so on. And our claim is that if we add up the n terms, we're going to get 2n squared plus n. This is the form of our proposition P of n that we're going to use. Okay. Step one, the basis step. We want to show that this is true for n equal 1. So in other words, for n equal 1, we want to show that the left side is equal to the right side. For n equal 1, the left side is just the sum from I equal 1 to 1 of 4i minus 1. The initial value of I is 1. The final value of I is 1. So what happens? We evaluate the sumand at the value of I equal 1. And we get 4 minus 1 is 3. And since this is not only the first term of the sum, but also the last term of the sum, that is our sum. We evaluate the sum from I equal 1 to I equal 1. There's one term when I equals 1. And we get 4 times I minus 1. Now, this is equal to 3. And to show that this is true for I equal 1, we take the left side evaluated at I equal, wrong. To show that this is true for n equal 1, we take the left side and evaluate it at n. So this n, we plug in 1 for that. And we take the right side and evaluate it at n. Two times 1 squared plus 1. And let's see. Is this equal to 3? Sure is. We've done what we were supposed to. But what I like to do is make sure that my reader understands what I've done. I don't have to do this next step, but for the sake of my reader, I'm going to. A lot of times when I do a proof, I follow the principles of public speaking. If we're giving a public talk, the first thing we do is we tell our audience what it is we're going to tell them. The next thing we do is we tell them. And then we conclude by telling them what it was we just told them. So here, in this step, we told them. In this step, we're going to tell them what it is that we just told them. Thing is equal to that thing. Our proposition evaluated at 1 is true. We've just shown that. Okay. Now on to the next step, which is our induction step, right? And in the induction step, we assume our proposition is true for some natural number k. And then we show that it has to be true for k plus 1 also. Let's do that. Step 2, the induction step. We assume that our proposition is true for n equal k. And we show that our proposition is true for k plus 1. The assumption that our proposition is true for n equal k is our induction hypothesis. Now, in terms of the actual proposition, we're going to assume that the sum from I equal 1 to k of 4i minus 1 is equal to 2k squared plus k. And we're going to show the proposition is true for k plus 1. That is the sum from I equal 1 to k plus 1 of 4i minus 1 is 2k plus 1 squared plus k plus 1. So what we're doing is we're just taking the original proposition where we have 2n squared plus n on the right side, and we're just putting k plus 1 every place that we see an n in the original proposition. Now, I'll tell you what. It may be hard to get our final result in terms of this. So I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to simplify this expression. Let's see, what is all of this when we simplify? K plus 1 squared, that's k squared plus 2k plus 1. So we're going to have 2k squared. We're going to have 4k plus k is 5k. And we're going to have 2 plus 1 is 3. So here's what we're going to do to make things easy on ourselves. We're going to assume the induction hypothesis, and then we're going to show that this is true. But essentially what we're going to do is show that this winds up equaling that, which is equivalent to 2k plus 1 squared plus k plus 1. So if we start with this and end with this, we've shown what it was that we want to show. Okay? Let me erase the board. Okay, we're back. And remember, we want to show that this thing, the sum from 1 to k plus 1 of 4i minus 1, is equal to this thing. So we start out with the sum from I equal 1 to k plus 1 of 4i minus 1. well, right off the bat, we're stuck because we don't know anything about the sum of 4i plus 4i minus 1 for I equal 1 to k plus 1. But we do know something about the sum of 4i minus 1 from I equal 1 to I equal k. This is our induction hypothesis. So the first thing we need to do is take this expression that we're working with and rewrite it in terms of our induction hypothesis, the proposition for I equal k, or n equal k. I just rewrote that in terms of this. Unfortunately, the two are not equal. So to atone for my sin, I have to put something here that will make this side of the equation equal to that side of the equation. What's the difference between this thing and this thing? Isn't the only difference the fact that we have one extra term here? We have a k plus first term, and this one only has the terms for I equal 1 through k. So this side is missing the term for k plus 1. So to compensate, I'm going to take this term and evaluate it at k plus 1. I'll have 4k plus 1 minus 1. Okay. And that's going to give me the sum from I equal 1 to k of 4i minus 1 plus, and what do we have here? 4k, 4 minus 1 is 3, so 4k plus 3. And you remember I said that in every proof that we do by induction, we have to use the induction hypothesis. That we haven't used it yet. Now, it's true, we introduced the sum from I equal 1 to k of 4i minus 1, but that's not our induction hypothesis. Our induction hypothesis is that the sum from I equal 1 to k of 4i minus 1 is equal to this thing. So here's where we use the induction hypothesis. I'm going to take this sum and replace it with its equivalent, 2k squared plus k. And I'll even let my reader know what I did here. And I keep this term the same. And the next step, let's see, 2k squared, k plus 4k is 5k, plus 3. Well, you know what? That's what we wanted to show. So in my next step, I'm going to tell my reader what it is I just told them. What I told them was, this thing is equal to that thing. So at this point, and I don't have to do this in my proof, but as a courtesy to my readers, I'm going to tell them what it is that I just told them. Which is exactly what it was that we were trying to establish. This is what we needed to show. Hence, I can conclude that my proposition is true for all natural numbers n. So that's our very first induction proof. Welcome back, everybody, to the land of strong induction. We're going to look at strong induction now. And here's how we perform a proof using strong induction. We suppose that our proposition is true for n equal 1. And then we suppose also that whenever the proposition is true for not just n equal k, but for n equal 1, 2, 3, dot, 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 all the way to k. In other words, if our proposition is true for all natural numbers less than or equal to k, then p evaluated at k plus 1 is true. Let me go over that again. Principle of strong induction. Suppose our proposition is true for n equal 1, and suppose it's also true for all natural numbers less than or equal to k. I'm not saying this right. Suppose also that whenever our proposition is true for all natural numbers less than or equal to k, then the proposition is true for k plus 1 also. That tells us that the proposition holds for all natural numbers. So what's the difference between this and weak induction? Here in the induction step, our hypothesis has a stronger requirement. With weak induction, our hypothesis just requires that the proposition is true for n equal k. And whenever the proposition is true for n equal k, then the proposition for n equal k plus 1 is true. Well, that means the proposition is true for all natural numbers. With strong induction, the induction hypothesis is that the proposition is true for all natural numbers less than or equal to k. And whenever that's true, if it's also true that the proposition for n equal k plus 1 is true, then the proposition is true for all natural numbers n. So this is called strong induction. The induction hypothesis has a stronger requirement. We don't just have to show that or assume that the proposition is true for n equal k. We have to assume the proposition is true for all natural numbers less than k. And we suppose that whenever this is true, then this is also true. If that's the case, then our proposition is true for all natural numbers n. Now, let me modify this just a little bit. It may be that we want to prove a proposition that's true for most natural numbers, but it's just not true for the first few natural numbers. Now, for example, our proposition may not be true for n equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3, but it's true for all natural numbers greater than 3. Now, we modify things just a little bit. Maybe the proposition's not true for n equal 1, but maybe it's true for n equal m, some natural number m. And we suppose that whenever the proposition is true for n equal m, m plus 1, m plus 2, all the natural numbers from m to k. Suppose it's true that whenever the proposition is true for the natural numbers from m to k, then the proposition is true for k plus 1 also. Then the proposition is true for, it's true for all natural numbers n equal m, m plus 1, m plus 2, and so on. So let's go over this again. Suppose that our proposition is true for n equals some natural number m. And I guess I chose m for minimum. And suppose also that whenever the proposition is true for n equal m, m plus 1, m plus 2, all the way up to k, then the proposition is true for k plus 1 also. Then it turns out the proposition is true for all natural numbers greater than or equal to m. This is strong induction because the hypothesis is stronger. It has a stronger requirement. It doesn't just require that the proposition is true for n equal k. It requires the proposition is true for all natural numbers from m all the way up to k. That's why we call it strong induction. It has a stronger hypothesis. Okay, let's do an example. Here's a nice exercise. We're going to play around with it for a little bit before we actually get into the proof, just to get a feel for what it is we're working with. What we're going to prove using strong induction is that every amount of postage greater than or equal to 12 cents can be paid using only 3-cent stamps and 7-cent stamps. Now, in terms of an equation or something like that, here's how we could write our proposition P of n. There exist integers n1 and n2, whole numbers, both of them non-negative, such that n1 times 3 plus n2 times 7 equals our postage n. And that makes sense. It may be that our postage can be paid using only 3-cent stamps, so N2 could be zero. It could be that our postage N could be paid using only 7 cent stamps, in which case N1 would be zero. It may be the case that our postage can be paid, but it requires a whole number of both 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps. So N1 is the number of 3 cent stamps, N2 is the number of 7 cent stamps. That gives us our postage N. Now, let's see. Let's just play around with this. We don't have 0 cent postage. P of 1. Is there any combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps that will give us 1 cent postage? Nope. Is there any combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps that will give us 2 cents postage? No. Is there any combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps that will give us 3 cents postage? Yeah. N1 equals 1. N2 equals 0. And we have 1 times 3 plus 0 times 7 equals 3 cents. The proposition is true for N equal 3. What about N equal 4? Can we get a combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps to give us 4 cents postage? Nah, that's false. 5, a combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps to give us 5 cents postage? Nope. 6, yeah, 2 3-cent stamps, right? So the proposition is true for 6, N1 equals 2, N2 equals 0, 2 times 3 plus 0 times 7 equals 6. By the way, we're doing this by strong induction. Later on in the course, when we study Diophantine equations, we'll find a completely different way to approach this. Okay, what about our proposition evaluated at N equals 7? Can we get a combination of 2 cent stamps and 3 cent stamps that will give us 7 cent? I'm sorry. Can we get a combination of 3 cent stamps and 7 cent stamps that will give us 7 cents postage? Sure. N1 equals 0, N2 equals 1, 0 times 3 cents plus 1 times 7 cents equals 7 cents. Okay, looking good. Can we get 8 cents postage? Nope, no way that's going to happen. 9 cents postage. That's true. 3 3-cent stamps, right? So we'll have N1 equal 3, N2 equals 0. 3 times 3 plus 0 times 7 equals 9. Yep, okay. N equal 10. Wait a minute. We can do this, can't we? This is true. N1 equals 1. N2 equals 1. 1 3-cent stamp, 1 7-cent stamp. That'll do it. 1 times 3 plus 1 times 7 is 10. Sure enough. Sure enough. True for 11? I don't think so. Nope, ain't gonna happen. 12? Sure enough. And 1 equals 4. And 2 equals 0. 4 3-cent stamps plus 0 7-cent stamps is 12 cents. Looks good. And what we're trying to prove is that any postage greater than or equal to 12 cents can be paid with just 3-cent stamps and 4-cent stamps. Well, let's see how this is turning out. 13 cents. That's true. How is that true? Well, let's see. It's true for 10 cents, so if we add another 3-cent stamp, we'll get 13 cents. So N1 equals 2, N2 equals 1. 2 3-cent stamps plus 1 7-cent stamp equals 13. We are looking good. Looking good. And 14, oh yeah. 14 is true, that's just 2 7-cent stamps, right? And 1, number of 3-cent stamps is 0. And 2, number of 7-cent stamps is 2. 0 times 3 cents plus 2 times 7 cents is 14. Okay. Now, here's where we're sort of going to see how this strong induction is going to work. Is our hypothesis true, or is the proposition true for 15 cents? Well, look at this. We have 3 trues in a row. The proposition was true for 12 cents. In other words, we can get 12 cents postage using 3-cent stamps and 7-cent stamps. So can we get 15 cents postage? Yeah. Just take this postage and add another 3-cent stamp. So N1 is going to be 5, and N2 is 0. So we have 5 times 3 plus 0 times 7 is 15. Okay, what about 16 cents? Well, look, 16 is just 3 more than 13, and we had postage for 13-cent stamps. So if we have 13-cent stamps, if we have 13 cents of postage, how do we get 16 cents of postage? Just add another 3-cent stamp, right? Okay. So here, N1 was 2. Add another 3-cent stamp. N2 was 1. And we have 3 times 3 plus 1 times 7 is 16. What about 17 cents? Well, that's going to be true, because it was true for the postage that's 3 cents less than 17. So we just add another 3-cent stamp. Here we had 0 3-cent stamps and 2 7-cents. Now we just add another 3-cent stamp. So keep the number of 7 cent stamps. So 1 times 3 plus 2 times 7 is 17. And do we see what's going on here? If we're looking at a postage greater than 14, let's say 15, all we have to do is say, you know what? We had the postage for 3 cents less, so we can get the postage for this by adding another 3 cent stamp. 16, well, sure we can do that because we had the postage for 3 cents less. 13, just add another 3 cent stamp. 17, sure, we have the postage for 14, just add another 3 cent stamp. And that's how we're going to work our strong induction proof. This isn't part of the proof. We were just feeling things out, playing around with the problem for a while. And you know what? Sometimes in math, that's exactly what we have to do before we try to prove something. Play around with it, poke it, prod it, experiment, see if we can notice some patterns. Pattern recognition is very important in math. Play around with it for a while, and if we do, we're probably going to see something that we can use in the proof. Now we do our proof. Step one, show true for n equal 12. Yeah, but there's a little bit more. In our scratch work, notice that it wasn't until we got three amounts of postage in a row that could be paid with 3 cents and 7 cent stamps that we could just say, okay, let's just take the amount that we need and go back three, take that postage and add a 3 cent stamp. These were the first three postages in a row that could be paid using only 3 cent, 4 cent, and 7 cent stamps. So let's see. Okay, P of 12 is true, P of 13, 2 3-centers, 1 7-center, 13, P of 13 is true, P of 14, what was that? Oh, 0 3-cent stamps, 2 7-cent stamps. Okay. The proposition's true for n equal 12, 13, and 14. That's step one. Now let's do step two. Here's our proposition on n. There exist non-negative integers n1, n2, such that n1 times 3 plus n2 times 7 is equal to n. We've shown that the proposition is true for 12, 13, 14. So assume that the proposition is true for k, where k is going to be at least 1 greater than 14. The proposition is true N1 times 3 plus N2 times 7 for some N1, N2 greater than or equal to 0. And N1 and N2 are integers. That's our induction hypothesis. You know what? That's not my induction. Well, it is. I'm sorry. I guess this shows there's no substitute for advanced preparation. I should have worked this out aforetime. But anyway, this is true. But what we really want to establish is that for k minus 2, there's N1 and N2, both non-negative integers, such that N1 times 3 plus N2 times 7 is equal to k minus 2. And this is true by our induction hypothesis. It's true for, 15 minus 1, it's true for 15 minus 2, and so forth. And it's true for, it's true for 15 minus 3, it's true for 16 minus 3, true for 17 minus 3. Okay. So, more correctly, this is our induction hypothesis. K plus 1 postage is equal to 3 plus k minus 2, which is equal to 3 times N1 times 3, N2 times 7. And that's going to be N1 plus 3 times 3 plus N2 times 7. And what did we just establish? There exists call this N1. Should this be a 3 here? If I take N1 and add one to it, that gives me one more 3 cent stamp. There's a non-negative whole number to multiply 3 by, n1 plus 1, plus a non-negative whole number, n2, to multiply 7 by, that will give us k plus 1 cents postage. So that was the induction step, that we showed that it was true for 12 all the way up to k, and then showed that it had to be true for k plus 1. So that's our strong induction proof. By the way, I think we've seen enough now that we should be able to do our first homework assignment on page 6. Next, we'll talk about combinations in the binomial theorem. Okay, the binomial coefficient. We see this, and when we see it, we say n choose k. N objects choose k. And what this represents the number of ways, disregarding the order of selection, that k objects can be selected from a set of n objects. The number of ways, without paying attention to the order of selection, that k objects can be chosen from a set of n objects. We can represent it this way or this way. And numerically, this is what it turns out to be. Let's look at some special cases of this. Let's look at some special cases just to see how they work out. If we actually take the numbers and plug them in, here 0 is our k, so we're going to have 0 factorial is 1. N minus 0 is n, so we have 1 times n factorial on the bottom. N factorial over n factorial is 1. Now, there's a common sense way of reasoning on this, in addition to plugging in the numbers. The number of ways that 0 objects can be selected from a set of n objects. There's only one way that we can select 0 objects from a set of n objects. We just leave everything right where it is. We don't choose any. That's the only way that we can select 0 objects from a set of n objects. We just leave them all there. The second case is very similar to the first. If we take n and plug it in for k, we have n factorial, and n minus n is 0. So we have n factorial times 0 factorial is n factorial. N factorial over n factorial is 1. But there's a common sense way of looking at this. How many ways can we select n objects from a set of n objects? There's only one way that we can select n objects from a set of n objects. We take them all. That's the only way to do it. Only one way to select n objects from a set of n objects. We just take everything. N choose one. Okay. There's a common sense way of looking at this. There are n ways of doing this. We choose one object. There are n different ways that we can do this. Do you see it? We can either take the first object, or we can take the second object, or we can take the third object, dot, 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 or we can take the nth object. There are n different ways that we can select one object. We either take the first one, or the second one, or the third one, dot, 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 or the nth one. Now, this is almost the same as this as far as reasoning goes. This is the number of ways that we can select n minus 1 objects from a set of n objects. And there's an easy way to reason on this if we have a flash of inspiration. If we have a set of n objects and we're going to select n minus 1 objects, how many objects are we going to leave behind? 1, right? So the number of ways that we can select n minus 1 objects from a set of n objects is exactly the same as the number of ways that we can take n objects and leave one behind. How many ways can we do that? That we can either leave the first one behind, or we can leave the second one behind, or we can leave the third one behind, dot, 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 or we can leave the nth one behind. There are n different ways that we can leave one object behind. And that's the same as taking n minus 1 objects. Okay, something else about the binomial coefficient. N choose k is exactly the same as n choose n minus k. N choose k, the same as n choose n minus k. Okay, well, by definition, here's what n choose k is. What about n choose n minus k? We're going to have n factorial on top. We're going to have this factorial here. And we're going to have n minus this factorial here. But n minus k is just k. And then I just take these two factors and switch them around to get that. But holy moly, this thing and this thing are the same. N choose k. So n choose k and n choose n minus k are exactly the same. These two things are equal. Now, again, there's a common sense reason why they turn out to be the same. If I'm choosing k objects out of a set of n, how many objects am I leaving behind? N minus k. In a set of n objects, how many ways can I choose n minus k objects to leave behind. N choose n minus k. So, in general, this is the number of ways that we can choose n objects. This is the number of ways that we can choose k objects from a set of n objects. This is also the number of ways that we could leave k objects behind in a set of n objects. If we choose k objects, we're leaving n minus k objects behind. They're one and the same thing. If we're going to take k objects with us, we're going to leave n minus k objects where they were. These two things are going to turn out to be numerically the same. And I did such a poor job of explaining that, maybe I should just do it again. This is the number of ways that we can take take k objects from a set of n. But if we take k objects from a set of n, we're leaving n minus k objects behind. This is the number of ways that we can choose n minus k objects from a set of n to leave behind. Numerically, they're going to be exactly the same. Now, one reason that we're interested in this is that we use this when we use the binomial theorem. And we'll look at the binomial theorem next. Here's the binomial theorem. And it tells us how we can take the sum of any two real numbers raised to the power of a non-negative integer. It tells us how we can compute the sum of two real numbers raised to the power of a non-negative integer. And this is what it is. The sum from I equals 0 to n, the binomial coefficient, n choose I, times a to the n minus I power, times b to the I power. Well, let's see how that works. You know what? Let's just try some specific cases. Here, n is 2. I is 0. So we have 2 choose 0, a to the 2 minus I, b to the I, which is 0. Now I becomes 1. We have 2 choose 1. A to the 2 minus I, B to the I is equal to 3. I is equal to 2. Yeah, that is a 2, isn't it? I is equal to 2. So we'd have 2 choose 2. A to the 2 minus I times B to the I. Two choose 0 is 1. B to the 0 is 1. 2 choose 1. let's see, we said n choose 1 is n, right? So 2 choose 1 is 2. A to the 2 minus 1. B to the 1. And 2 choose 2, that's going to be 1. A to the 0, which is 1.
Oh, no. Windows is about to restart. Don't you dare do that. 14 minutes remaining. Okay, we can do this.
We get a squared plus 2ab plus b squared. Did it work? Yeah. A plus B squared is A squared plus 2AB plus B squared. I was going to do one more example, A plus B cubed, but I'll leave that up to you, since my computer apparently is going to be